In today's episode, we're going to go through setting up a Ruby and Rails development environment from scratch using Docker, not even installing Ruby onto your machine. In previous episodes, we've looked at how Docker and images can be used to transport code from one machine to another and to have easily duplicated environments. So today we're going to apply that to a Ruby and Rails development environment. We're also going to be using Postgres as our database and having two separate containers running and talking to each other, running the entire Rails stack on the Docker infrastructure, not on your machine. Before we get started with this tutorial, you're going to want to make sure that you have Docker installed already. If you don't, then you can go ahead and watch one of the other videos that we've made. To get started, we're going to have to go get two images that we haven't used before. The first one is going to be the official Ruby image from Docker Hub, and the second one is going to be the official Postgres image from Docker Hub. To download these images, you're going to run docker pull and then the name of the image. For our Ruby image, we want Ruby with a specific tag of 2.3, just to make sure that we're all running the right version of Ruby. I already have this image installed. For Postgres, we can just use Postgres. We'll use latest. The version here is really not going to be that important for us. I already have the latest version of Postgres too. I downloaded those before the episode just so I wouldn't have to have the download progress going on. Our next step is going to be generating a Rails application. And we're going to do this without actually using Rails on our machine. We've talked in the past about how containers can be used to run entire applications like Postgres, our database, or they can be used to run one-off things. This is going to be one of those examples where we're going to use a container to go in, do a few things, have it change something on our system using a new feature that we haven't talked about called volume sharing, and then we're just going to let that container go away. The command we're going to use is docker run with this --rm, which means remove the container when it's finished running. It needs to be interactive. And then we want to share through a volume. And this is going to look a little bit weird. And what this is saying here is that take our current working directory, so the folder that we're currently in, and share it through into the container as /app. We want to use the Ruby 2.3 image. And we want to run bash because we're going to need to run more than one command while we're inside the container. Now that we're in the container, we're going to cd into the app directory. You'll see that there's nothing here because we were working in an empty directory previously. We're going to gem install Rails. I'm going to stop the recording and just fast forward through this because it can take a while. Before we run this next step, I want to just prove to you something. If we look over here in our Docker and development folder, you'll see that there's nothing there. When we type ls to list out the contents, there's nothing. But over here, we're going to run the Rails generator. Since we just installed Rails, we can generate a blog with PostgreSQL kind of pre-configured. And then we'll tell it to skip bundle because we don't want it to install any more gems in this container because we're going to get rid of it. It generates all these files, which you can see is /blog. And then if we bounce back over here, you can see we now have /blog. We're going to exit this container now, and it's just going to go away. But we will have those files in our local file system. Now that we have a Rails application, we're going to move into our blog directory, and we're going to write our first real Docker file. We created one in a previous episode, but that didn't have much meat to it. This one actually has quite a few things going on. As we will with every Docker file we write, we need to have a jump-off point. For us, that's going to be the Ruby 2.3 image that we downloaded. The first thing that we're going to run is an update on the apt-cache so we can install the Postgres client that we need so that our application can talk to our database. So we tell it to update and to be quiet. And then we're going to actually chain a bunch of these things on because remember that each run declaration that we say or copy or command, those all create a separate image that gets cached. So whenever you're installing things or updating things, it's a common practice in Dockerland to do that all in one command so that it creates one cache layer. So we're going to install We're going to not install the recommended packages just because those are extra packages that we may not need. And the, whoops, we actually don't want these ands here. We want to install the PostgreSQL client. And then we want to additionally, this is a little advanced, but we're going to get rid of the apt cache again, even though we updated to get it so we could install an item, but then we're going to get rid of it because we want to keep our image as small as possible. Next up, we're going to create our working directory, and this is just where we're going to start from. That's going to be in user source app. It's important that we know where this is at because later on we're going to share through our local file system into the container as it's running, but I'll get to that when we actually get this thing running. We're going to copy. This is a new thing for us, and that just means take something from our local machine, put it into the image as you're building it, and then it'll stay in the image as it was when they copied it. So for this, we're going to put in all of our gemfile files. So that's the gemfile and the gemfile lock. Next, we're going to run bundle install, and this will install all of our gems. Finally, we're going to copy all of the files from our local machine into the container. And the reason we did it in this weird order is that we want changes to the gem file to be a cache layer that caused the bundle install to need to occur. But if you change any other file besides a gem file, you don't want that to require us to reinstall gems because that's a timely operation. We have a few more lines to put in here. We need to expose 3000. And what this means is the port in our container of 3000, we want that to be accessible from the Docker host. And that's the machine that runs the containers. And lastly, we want by default to have our image run the Rails server, and we need it to bind to 0000. This binding is specific for some networking things inside of Docker. By default, Rails would sometimes use 127.0.0.1, and you would have some weird issues where you couldn't connect to your container. So it's safe to just always use zeros. The next thing that we need to change is make one little tweak in the gem file, and that is to install the Ruby Racer. This is a JavaScript runtime, and we didn't install Node into our container, but Rails requires this in order to compress and compile JavaScript. So we're going to do that before we build our image. There is actually one more thing we do need to change, and that is going to be our database configuration. So if we go to config database, there's a lot of stuff in here we don't need. We're just going to get rid of it. But we're going to start putting some things up in here. So for the host, we're going to have it be DB. This is a weird string, and this will come in when we connect our two containers that we're going to be having together. But Docker does some nifty things with registering a network that'll allow DB to just point to the Postgres container. So we'll use DB here. Then we need a username, which we're going to fetch from an environment variable. And then we need a password, which we're also going to fetch from an environment variable. Okay, going down, this is right. We're going to have our test database. And then even though we're not going to be running this thing in production, we would want a different host down here. So just for being thorough, in case anybody does decide they want to deploy something exactly like this, you would have something like Postgres host down here. Okay, so we're going to save that. Let's go and double check our Docker file. Oh, I actually forgot to tell where to copy this. So we want it to copy into our directory here. So we're going to save that. We're going to bounce back over here, and we're going to run Docker build. We're going to tag it as blog and then tell it to use the Dockerfile of where we currently are. This is going to take a little while because it has to install gems. So I'm once again going to pause this and I'll come back when it's done. Okay, now we can actually start building containers since we have images that we can use. But one thing we're going to need, which we saw from the environment variables that we put in the database configuration, is that we need those to exist. We're going to make them exist on our machine first, and then we're going to pass those in to the containers. We're just going to set these environment variables in our current shell right now. So we're going to use export Postgres user. This is going to be CoderJourney, and export Postgres password, which is going to be a super secure ABCD1234. This normally isn't the way you would do this. Kind of tedious. If I close the shell, I'm not going to be able to access it. But for right now, we're just going to do it this way. We're going to utilize these environment variables across our Docker network. And we're going to create our own custom network right now to connect our database container to our application container. So first, let's see what kind of networks we have. We have a couple there already, and you can see that I already have a blog one. But I'm going to delete that right now. Oh, whoops. Docker network rm blog. So if we look at our networks again, you see there's nothing there. But I'm actually just going to recreate that exact network. So we're going to use Docker network create. We're going to call it blog because we're writing a blog right now. Now we're going to create this database container, connect it to our blog network. That way our application container can connect to it later. I'm going to warn you that this Docker command is going to get a little long. We're going to run Docker run. Dash D means daemonize, which is just to have it keep running in the background. And then we want to do a dash E, and this is to pass through our environment variables. So we're going to pass through Postgres user, and we want to set that to what the value of our local Postgres user. And then we're going to do Postgres password and set that to the value of our local. Postgres password. Then we want to set a network of blog, set a name of DB, and then tell it to use the Postgres image. We're not running anything custom on this. We just want it to run Postgres. And since Postgres runs as a daemon anyway, a continual process, this will just go off. And it sends us right back to our own prompt. So if we run Docker PS, you can now see that we have one container running that is a Postgres image. And off to the right there, you see that the name is DB. Next up, we're going to use our blog image, and we're going to run a one-off command that will create our database. We'll then tear this container down and run our Rails application in another container. So for this, we're going to use a very similar command. So I'm actually going to just push up a few times. And then from here, we will go and remove this dash D because we want this one to actually go away. So we're going to say dash dash RM. Doesn't need a name. It's not going to be called the Postgres image either, but this is going to use our blog. Remember, we're actually going to pass through one command that's going to exit, and then it's going to instantly tear itself down. So this is going to be rake db setup. And there you go. We created a database. Our last step here is going to be to actually run our Rails application. And for this, it is actually going to be daemonized like our database. So we're going to go back up here and use this daemonized sequence passing through the Postgres environment variables with the same network. But we're going to change this. So we're going to say it's app. The container is going to be blog, or the image is going to be blog. But we also need to pass through a volume that is going to be our current working directory again to user src app. And that's so that any change we make locally will be reflected inside. We're then going to expose the port, which you might remember we said expose 3000. So this is saying take 3000 from inside our container and expose that as 3000 on our Docker host. So we're going to do 3000 to 3000. We called it app, and we're running the blog image. So now if we run Docker PS, we have the blog and we have Postgres running. Over here in the browser, you can see the localhost 3000 just refreshed, and it is our Rails landing page. To show that this Rails landing page isn't the only landing page we can possibly have, we're going to go write some Rails code that's going to change this to just say hello world, and that without ever needing to restart our container. From in Atom, we're going to redefine a route here. So we're going to get rid of this. We're just going to say root to, and then we're going to say welcome controller to the show action. So we're going to save that. And then in app controllers, we need to create a new one. It's going to be called welcome controller. This code here really isn't that important. It's just a matter of, I want to show you what we can do here. So we're going to render text that just says, hello from Docker. If we save that, and we go back to our browser, and we refresh, you'll see this says, hello from Docker. We didn't have to do anything. It just automatically, since we shared through the volume, put that into our running container. In part two of this tutorial on using Docker in development, we're going to use Docker Compose to automate a lot of the tedious work that we've done here. So stay tuned for that. I hope you liked this video. If you did, I would really appreciate it if you could like it, share it, and subscribe. And let me know what you would like to learn about.